morning, everybody. If you're joining us for our Sunday School Hour, we're still in the book of Proverbs. If you're following along in the quarterly, or if you're using the quarterly as your extra study guide, the lesson today is about pleasing God. The July 26th edition of the lesson starts on page 73, and as all other, this is what we learn as when we teach the Bible or preach the Bible, or when you and I study the Bible, that it always speaks in so many different ways. It is a book of many subjects and many ideas, many things that God wants us to know or to learn. And so any teacher or preacher, anybody who picks up the Bible might approach it from a different direction or see something a little bit differently or home in on a particular subject. Pleasing God is the direction that our lesson authors have pursued. I have a different title, and I'm going to zoom in on that particular subject today, but we're still calling the study of the book of Proverbs smart living. We're not looking at every chapter or every verse. Today, we'll be looking at Proverbs chapter 15. Proverbs chapter 15, we're still picking up smart living, and we see that it is evident that Solomon and the other writers that are included in the book of Proverbs in its 31 chapters are not all that interested in talking about the temple or about Sabbaths or holidays or holy days. They're not talking about sacrifices, or there's never any encouragement to go talk to a priest if you need advice. They're really talking about having a relationship with God where God is able to lead us and guide us, and that God has created us with a common sense, and He has laid out a path for us. So today, I'm calling my lesson, starting, and we're looking at the same chapters, looking at the same verses, Life is a Highway. Life is a highway. Now, obviously, this is the direction that the people who made this highway, they say, go this way. Highways generally follow paths that people have been traveling for many, many years. Indian trails, sometimes even rabbit trails, I guess. Natural paths that follow the landscape, assuming that this is the way it's safest for us to go. This is the way maybe God wanted us to go, because this is the way He made the mountains and the rivers and the natural guides that lead us from place to place. Now, you know, there's an entire industry today that creates and manufactures what are called or known as off-road vehicles. And people like to go off-road. That means here's a highway. We know we're on the highway and we're headed in a particular direction. But everyone knows that there's more excitement, there are lots of thrills, there's danger, and there's greater experiences that are out there that are off-road. And so there are vehicles, and sometimes people go off-road when they don't even have a four-wheel drive or an off-road vehicle or an off-road motorcycle, a dirt bike, a dune buggy, that kind of thing. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the off-road recreation, but in life's highway, sometimes getting off the path that God has designed for us is not good. It's going to always lead to trouble. So we're going to look at a few more images today where He's talking about what we say in our mouth, our lips, the words that come from our heart. But He's going to talk more and more about this is the way God has designed things to work and to be, and following His direction, being on God's highway on our life is prudent. It's what's wise. It's the best. It's because God's highway always ends up at God. Here's Proverbs chapter 15, starting with verse 1. It says, here's some general words of advice. A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise adorns knowledge, but the mouth of the fool gushes folly. Now, foolishness and folly, they're of course related. Folly is anything that is laden with foolishness or headed toward foolishness. And he says the mouth of the fool gushes folly. In other words, he just more the more and more he talks, the more nonsense he produces. The eyes of the Lord are everywhere, keeping watch over the wicked and the good. Remember, we've already looked at, be careful, little hands, what you do. Be careful, little mouth, what you say. There's a God up above who is looking down in love. So be careful, little hands. Careful, little feet, where you go. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. He's keeping a watch on the wicked and the good. The soothing tongue is a tree of life, but a perverse tongue crushes the spirit. I looked, here are some people that look, I have no idea what they're saying, but we might imagine all of us have used unkind words at one time or another. Now, we have said, well, I was in a bad mood, I didn't feel well, I was under a lot of pressure, I was under some stress, I wasn't thinking, I didn't mean to say that. But we have found that once you ring a bell, you can't unring it. Once you say something, it is already been said. And then we do say things that we really don't mean. We say things that we didn't intend to hurt on the surface. But here is what the writer of Proverbs is saying. Sometimes we can be very harsh and very hard to people. We don't, and even sometimes the Proverbs, as Solomon said, harsh words or angry words, they seldom accomplish anything of any value. The writer James, the half-brother of Jesus, said in his first chapter, the wrath of man does not accomplish the righteousness of God. And so in our anger, in our being mad at someone, that is when we're going to be least like Christ. Now, there is such a thing as righteous indignation, and there are some things that should stir our ire. There are things that are worthy of our anger. There are things that should upset us and draw us to passionate feelings. But we need to be very careful, because it is in those times of great heated emotion that we often say the wrong things or take the wrong actions. A fool spurns a parent's discipline, but whoever heeds correction shows prudence. The house of the righteous contains great treasure. Now, we know that, I don't know if you've ever heard of Solomon's mines. There are still people that are looking for Solomon's mines. Solomon had a lot of gold, a lot of silver and precious gems. Well, it is probably because he had people under his employ or his subjects who discovered where those things could be found. And so he did have mines. He did have, he knew where treasure was. I watched a lot of these things on the Discovery Channel. These people, the mystery of Oak Island, or the secrets of Oak Island. People looking for treasure. I guess people have found buried treasure in the past, but it seems about everything that I know about pirates is that they like to spend money. And the reason they were pirates is because they were always out of money of their own, and they needed your money. So the idea that pirates would rob a treasure from some passing ship, then go put it in a hole in the ground, seems contradictory to me. I think that they might have hidden some treasure here or there if the authorities were hot on their trail. But I think the very first chance they got, they went back and dug that up and went and had a party somewhere. Here, Solomon's talking about treasure in a house. And I know, and you and I both know, that he's not talking about gold and silver, precious stones and money. He's talking about the house of the righteous contains great treasure because of the righteousness that's there. It's the joy and the happiness and the love that is in that house. He says, the income of the wicked brings ruin. The lips of the wise spread knowledge, but the hearts of fools are not upright. You know, almost anything that leans is weak. Anything that leans is not strong. It has problems. Sometimes we have to lean, and sometimes when we do, we need to lean on the Lord. I love that old song, "Learning to Lean." I'm learning to lean upon Jesus. Well, the Lord wants us to stand upright. When we need to lean on something or someone, He does want us to lean on Him. But the Bible talks more about standing than it does about leaning. The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked. Now we're going to look here. This is the NIV translation. And here the translators translated a word, detests. The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked, but the prayer of the upright pleases Him. We're going to break this word about detesting something down in just a moment. He says the Lord detests the offering of the wicked. Now, we might put our mind to this. Why would a person need to offer an offering? Now, when we think of offering, we think of putting money in an offering plate. Well, that's not what they did in Solomon's day. They didn't give God money back in the Old Testament times. The offerings that they made were sacrifices for sin. And so he's talking about, if you sin and you come and bring your offering, you're asking God for forgiveness. But here it says, God detests the offering of the wicked. Now, there's a difference in being a sinner, and it's really talking about someone, he's talking about someone who is making an offering to God, but it's just a religious act. God, here's a person, he's not offering this because he's a sinner. But he's offering this for some other reason, and that makes him a step further. He's wicked.
Kind of like what the Pharisees did in Jesus' day.
Exactly. And this is a drawing that's based upon something Jesus said. There's a pulpit, and there's a church altar, and we don't know what's in that bowl that he brought to present. But Jesus said, if you bring something to the altar, and again, we're thinking of the step or the platform at the front of the church, an altar is where they laid an animal, a dead animal's body, and burn it. But Jesus said, if you bring your offering or your sacrifice to the altar, and there you remember that you've got something against your neighbor, He says, leave your sacrifice. Well, what if somebody gets it? That really doesn't matter. What if it's not there when I get back? What if it's just wasted? Won't I have to get another? Well, you know, that's the whole point is that obviously, Jesus was saying, obviously, you don't get it. You don't understand it. God doesn't want dead animals. God cares nothing about blood. God cares nothing about your performance of a religious sacrifice. But it's in the law. Yeah, it is. But you're missing the whole point of the law. You see, the law was about being people who were close to God, and that loved each other. Loved God and loved each other. The law was about being a good person. About being the person who was on God's path. Someone who was following. God said, do this. And if we did that, then it would bring us closer to God. God had constructed that command so that if we obeyed it, it would, regardless of what the command was or what it accomplished or didn't accomplish, just simply performing it would bring us closer to God. There are things that my parents asked me to do when I was a child that all of those things that I did as a child, they're gone now. They were not lasting. But I still remember the relationship I had with my mom and dad. And I really remembered it when I had my own children and I needed to instruct them. I gave them many chores to do, and I gave them many commands and orders, not because I was simply as a parent wanting to boss them around, but I was raising them up to be adults and to be mature. Jesus said, you're missing the whole point about offerings and sacrifice and about your faith and your religion. Jesus said, this is what it's about. And if you don't get that, God even said, it's not just a Jesus thing. Solomon said in the Old Testament that God detests the offerings or the gifts or the sacrifices of the wicked. He says, we see it very, very plainly in the prophets when in Isaiah chapter 1, God said, that smoke is coming up off the altar from your sacrifice. He says, that's making me sick. It's making me sick, that smell, because he knew what was in their hearts. Some people don't get it. They miss the whole point that we have to do this, 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 this. God says, well, it's not a list to check off. He says it is steps toward becoming and to development, to building. Last week in Vacation Bible School, we started the themes of God working in us, God building us. God's making something in your life. He's making someone in my life. And that's the point. You see, as Randy said, the Pharisees were people who had dotted all the I's. They'd crossed all the T's. And yet, they did not love each other. They didn't love God. They didn't understand the purpose and the point of the law. They thought, if we keep all the commandments, then God is happy. God said, look, that's not the point. The reason they hated Jesus is that Jesus exposed the most churchified and templified and religious people. He exposed them as bad people. Well, listen to what Jesus said. He said, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees, you will in no wise see the kingdom of heaven. You see, the common man in Jesus' day thought that they were so far beneath the Pharisees and the religious leaders that they had no hope of getting to heaven. They'd lost all hope. That's why they loved Jesus, because Jesus came and gave them hope of salvation. And here Jesus said, if you can't be the way they are, you'll never get to heaven. And they thought, well, that's just impossible. You mean we can't be like them? You mean we've got to be better than them? Well, being better than them, only God can do that in your life and mine. Here, the Lord detests, here's that word again in the NIV. The Lord detests the way of the wicked, but he loves those who pursue righteousness. Stern discipline awaits anyone who leaves the path. The one who hates correction will die. Death and destruction lie open before the Lord. How much more do human hearts? Mockers resent correction, so they avoid the wise. If you display godly wisdom in your life, there are people who will avoid you. Now, if people are avoiding you because you're obnoxious, or you're annoying, or you're irritating, that's one thing. But you will find that people do not want to be around godly people who are not themselves pursuing godliness. The Lord detests the way of the wicked. Let's look at that. All right, I see that this computer, I forgot to check, does not have the Hebrew font in it. So that looks just about as happy in this language as it did in Hebrew. So, but there it is. It's the word Tobet. I need this as my notes too. Tobet. I'll install that later. But it's really not so much to show you as it is for me, because this is the word that is in our English Bible often translated abomination. It's a terrible word. And that is what the NIV says. The Lord detests this. In some version, it says God hates this or that. Abomination. In Luke chapter 16, verse 15, Jesus said to the Pharisees, you are those who justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. For what is important to men is abomination in the sight of God. Yeah, that's another reason why Jesus was not liked by the Pharisees. Now, Jesus loved the Pharisees and he died for them. He saved a number of them, among them Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, and also one of the best known Pharisees in all of Christendom was Paul, or the first Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul the Apostle. Now, there are many things that are described as abominations in the Old Testament. And these are the things with God's greatest and most stern warning. A lot of the things that are in the book of Leviticus that are described, here's a list of things that these these are an abomination. Now, pardon me, let me go back one track. I want to have this word before us, not the Hebrew word there, but the English word. The law was given to the people of Israel when they were out in the wilderness. We don't realize that a great deal of the law of Moses was specifically for the Jewish people and for that specific time, and to get them through the wilderness time of their highway with God. For instance, a great deal of the book of Exodus is about how to construct and build the tabernacle. That was to be the tent of meeting. That's where God would meet with them, the tabernacle. There was an enclosure, a linen fence, and a fence post, and a linen, it wasn't like a fortress, but it was a barrier. The tent that was in the middle of the courtyard that was surrounded by that fabric enclosure, was a tent made of animal skins. It probably wasn't very glorious looking. Layers of animal skins sewn together. And then there was furnishings, different pieces of furniture inside the holy place, which was the first compartment in that tent. And then the most holy place, which was a place that only the high priest could go, the back part of that tent. This was for the Jewish people. And it was for the time that they traveled. They needed something they could roll up and pack up and go to the next camp and set it up there. And so the tabernacle was for them. And so this is a part of the law that we can say, okay, that's a very concrete example of something that God doesn't want us to build a tabernacle. We don't need a tabernacle. It's not something that's a part of the law of God that we are neglecting. It is obvious that was a phase or an important event, an important time in the life of the Jewish people. There are many things in the Old Testament law that was to get them from the beginning of their journey to the land of promise. Now, there were a lot of dietary laws. It seems unusual that God might say, don't eat this or that. And it makes God look kind of peculiar. It makes God seem to be a little bit strange or unusual to say, you can't eat this kind of food or that kind of food. Now, I've been to the land of Egypt, and many of them today are Muslims. But in ancient times, the Egyptians ate just about anything from scorpions to camels. Very few exclusions. Even the things that they deemed as holy, they thought eating them made them holy. For instance, God, let me ask you, if you know, as far as our diet and what we eat as human beings, do you know what a kind of food that's probably more dangerous to eat than any other kind of food today because of allergies and reactions and because of disease? Do you know what kind of food that is that you actually, every time you eat it, you're taking your life in your hand? A lot of people have peanut allergies today, but that's still very, very, very rare. But there are thousands of people every year, all around the world, thousands and thousands of people die from eating this food. You know what it is? Any guesses?
Dairy.
Shellfish.
Shellfish. Like
shellfish.
Oysters. Clams.
That's right. Clams, oysters, crabs, lobster, crawfish, crawdads. Shellfish. It's crustaceans. It's a whole wide. And it used to be far more dangerous. Now, we probably live in a time right now when you can go down to the Gulf Shores, or you even locally, you can eat shellfish just about, there were certain guidelines. If the month of the year ended in the letter R, you're not supposed to eat shellfish. But now they sell them year round because they're not seasonal anymore. They have farms where they're raised. Probably all of the shellfish or seafood that you eat today has been raised in a controlled fishery, a farm, and under very, very particular guidelines. Also, when they are harvested, when they are cleaned, and when they are transported, and when they are sold, and when they are served, there are FDA guidelines. Now, you're an Israelite. You're out in the middle of the Sinai Desert. God says, do not eat any shrimp. It's abomination. What does that sound like? How do you think that they got, you know, God wouldn't have told them that unless that was a possibility. How, out in the middle of the desert, would they have come in contact with shellfish and clams and oysters and lobsters and crabs? You see, we have a tendency to think of these people out there in the middle of the desert, and they're completely closed off, they're completely isolated. But you know, about a fourth of the Old Testament law is about how they're to treat strangers. And I'll tell you what, you can go out right now in the middle of the Sinai Desert and put up a tent. You know what's going to happen the very next day? Somebody's going to come knocking on your door to sell you something.
Yeah.
Traders, businessmen, caravans of people who have things that they have brought from faraway places. And you know what they've got a tow sack of? Something you've never seen before. Crawdads, shrimp, and you know what they tell you? We caught these 2 days ago. They're fresh. You know what they'll do to you? They'll kill you dead as a hammer. Now, these Israelite people, they had obviously these things. God says, don't eat this and that kind of thing. You say, well, where are they going to get that? There's nothing but sand out there in the desert. There were people traveling that they met all the time that came and went every day. Every time that there's too many people over here, that's a market. That's a place to go sell things. But listen, there's something intrinsic about that kind of food. It's very, very difficult to keep it fresh, to store it, to transport it. Think of 4,000 years ago, somebody selling you shrimp. If it's dangerous today, how dangerous was it back then?
Well, they didn't even have an old-fashioned ice box.
No, not a bit. They didn't even really know about storing things with salt or curing things or smoking things. A little bit, but not much. Of all the different kinds of meat, do you know what kind of meat is more susceptible to carrying deadly disease? What kind of animal meat?
Probably pigs.
Chicken.
What did you say, Randy?
It'd be pigs, I guess.
Pigs, pork. Now chickens, chickens will go bad. But you can kill a fresh hog that just died right now and eat the meat from it just 2 minutes after you killed it, and it'll give you cholera if it had cholera. And it carries cholera. There have been millions of people died in human history that were carried by pigs. Now, why am I saying this? If you look at all the different things that they were to eat and not to eat, you'll find out that God was saying, we've got to get through the wilderness here. And all of God's laws had to do with protecting them and getting them through the desert. If you eat these kinds of foods, they didn't have... Eating pork would have been one of the most dangerous things they could have done. It's not because pigs are bad or because this is religiously unacceptable. God was giving them, he was saying this is an abomination. Now, we need to apply this also to other things. There were other things that God said about sexual immorality. It was not just God said, this is unclean, this is nasty, that's bad, that's not good, that's morally wrong. In every case, you'll find out when God is prohibiting something, it's because it's harmful to us. In some way, if you follow this path, if you go down this highway, if you jump off the highway and get off-road on this particular pathway, you're endangering yourself. Now, it's one thing for you and I to endanger ourselves by disobeying God. What was at stake? Listen to this very carefully. What was at stake when the Jewish people disobeyed God? What was at stake? The Messiah.
The Messiah.
The Messiah. Salvation. Christmas. These people were specifically chosen because God says, this is where my plan of salvation is coming. That's why when they disobeyed God or departed from God, that's why the salvation of all humanity was at stake. It's different than when I disobey God. Or when you disobey God, when the Jewish people disobeyed God, the Messiah was at stake, salvation, the Savior. God, it was not about, the religion of the Hebrew people was about preserving them as a people and as a nation and preserving their faith for one reason. Not so that they would be religious people, or so that they would be obedient people. But their religion and their obedience was about bringing forth the Savior. A happy heart makes the face cheerful, but heartache crushes the spirit. The discerning heart seeks knowledge, but the mouth of a fool feeds on folly. Remember a while ago he says, the mouth of the fool gushes folly. He says they feed on it too. They feed on it. All the days of the oppressed are wretched, but the cheerful of heart has a continual feast. Better a little with the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. You can tell a lot about what's going on in a person's life, not trying to be nosy or trying to pry, but sometimes just being someone who cares for other people, you can tell. You can see pain on their face. You can see the struggles that they're going through. I love to see a smiling face. I love things that make me smile. He says a cheerful face also makes the heart cheerful. Terry was talking about our great niece and how she was trying to get away with a fake cry. You can tell a fake smile, can't you? When someone's smiling at you and it's just a plastered on face. A hot-tempered person stirs up conflict, but the one who is patient calms a quarrel. I've heard people say, well, I'm just a hot-tempered person. Well, don't do that. Don't be that kind of change. I'm just the kind of person, I lose my temper. That's just who I am. Well, a hot-tempered person stirs up conflict. Sometimes we make excuses for the kind of person we are when we might be that's the wrong kind of person to be. There have been lots of occasions in my life when God has come to me and says, you're this kind of person, but we're going to change that. Have you ever heard anybody say, well, I was born this way? You know what you got to be in order to get to heaven?
Born again.
You got to be born again. God's okay the way you were born. Maybe you were born that way. God says, well, you got to be born again. you can't go around and say, well, I was born this way. Well, that's all right. Maybe you were. Maybe he's born exactly that way. Does that mean that's the way you were supposed to be? No, God said, no, I don't like the way you were born. You got to be born again. And what that means is you got to become a different person. The way of the sluggard is blocked with thorns, but the path of the upright is a highway. A wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish man despises his mother. Folly brings joy to the one who has no sense. But whoever has understanding keeps a straight course. Talking about the highway of God. God intends us to make forward progress, to get ahead, to go somewhere, to make some progress, to put something behind us, to reach out to something ahead of us. Plans fail for lack of counsel, But with many advisors, they succeed. A person finds joy in giving, and after a plot, how good is a timely word? The path of life leads upward for the prudent. He says that's where God's highway goes, to keep them from going down to the realm of the dead. The Lord tears down the house of the proud, but he sets the widow's boundary stones in place. The Lord detests, and here he said in the King James Version, it says, it is an abomination the thoughts of the wicked, but gracious words are pure in his sight. The greedy bring ruin to their household, but the one who hates bribes will live. The heart of the righteous weighs its answers, but the mouth of the wicked gushes evil. He's already said it gushes folly. He said it gushes evil, too. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayers of the righteous. Light in the messenger's eyes brings joy to the heart. What he's saying here is, you're a messenger, and you ought to always be sharing good news with everybody you see. He says the light in a messenger, when people see you coming, they should see the light in your eyes because they know that you're bringing some good news. The gospel is the best news that we have. Do people dread seeing you coming because you just always pour cold water over everything and because all you have is the down and the out and the grumpy and the grouchy? Good news gives health to the bones. Listen, there's plenty of truth out there that is bad news. There is more and more in the world that the Lord has built of good news. Whoever heeds life-giving correction will be at home among the wise. Those who disregard discipline despise themselves, but the one who heeds correction gains understanding. Wisdom's instruction is to fear the Lord, and humility comes before honor. Let me close this out. I want to close this out with one of my favorite hymns. Let me play it for you. We'll play just a little bit of it. It may not be to your taste, but I enjoyed listening to it while I made this preparation, and I hope you enjoy it too. Life is a highway. Evidently, my laptop wants to update, and it's not going to let me turn the volume up anymore. Because it won't even give me a mouse cursor. There's the church, people, right there.